All right. Hello, everyone. Thanks for joining us this evening. I am Jonathan from Rivendell Coins, and the topic of this coin class centers on what I think are very interesting coins, particularly if you are interested in coins that circulated in colonial America and in the Caribbean in the 1600s, and those coins are Spanish Maravedis. And before we begin, there are a few housekeeping items. I'll try to keep an eye on the chat, but I do have quite a few windows open. So if you have a question, you can either jot it down and ask at the end of the stream. We'll have a Q&A if need be. Or if you put my name in chat with the at sign, I hopefully will notice it. And we have scheduled this talk for about an hour, but I'm not sure if it will take that long, so we may end a bit early. And I've posted lecture notes, if we can call them that, on the Rivendell Coins website. I have the links for those notes in the video description, should be. And if not, put that in chat. And the background music, yeah, it's of the period. It's a few decades later, actually. Hopefully it doesn't drown anything out. In fact, can somebody let me know, give me a thumbs up or some sort of notation about the audio? Is the audio okay? And can you see the coin in the center screen? What else? Oh, and we'll have a viewer appreciation prize. I'll be giving away a set of Maravedis coins to the lucky viewer. In fact, those are the coins. If you're interested in participating in that, we'll do that at the end of the stream. Okay, well, let's get back to here. And in this discussion, like I said, we're going to talk about hand-struck or hammered Maravedis that were minted in Spain from the early to mid 1600s. And you're looking at one right now. This is an 8 Maravedis coin, and the word Maravedis comes from the name of one of the early Muslim ruling families of Spain, the Almoravids, who minted a gold coin that was widely used, widely accepted in Europe. And when Spain came back under Christian rule, that type of gold coin continued to be minted by the Spanish, and they just called it the Maravedi after the early rulers. Now, eventually the Maravedi went from being a gold coin to changing to a silver coin. Then it became a billin, which is a coin that is mostly copper, but has a small amount of silver in it. But by 1600, the Maravedis was a copper coin that circulated alongside the silver Spanish real and the gold escudo. And most of the copper that was used in minting the Maravedis came from the copper mines of Sweden. That's where most of Europe got its copper at that time. So, beginning in 1602, since we're talking about the 1600s, there was a need for small coinage in Spain and in her colonies in the New World. So, King Philip III issued a decree that Maravedis would be minted at what are known as the old mints in Spain. Those were in Madrid, Seville, Toledo, Granada. There's one in Valladolid, one in Sequenza, and there were a few others. And the Maravedis' value was pegged by the crown at 34 Maravedis to one silver real. So this is an 8 Maravedis coin. So it would take 4 of these plus a 2 Maravedis coin to equal 1 silver real. And just for comparison, there we go. That obviously is a buffalo nickel. So it's the 8 Maravedis coin is about the same size and actually about the same weight as a nickel, a U.S. nickel. Right about 5 grams. But there was a variance too. So yeah, the Maravedi was to colonial Spain what the halfpenny or the penny was to the British colonies. It was a coin that was widely used, and it served the purpose of smaller day-to-day business transactions. Now, we do know that Maravedi circulated in the Spanish colonies as well as the English colonies because they have been uncovered in Santo Domingo, which is the modern Dominican Republic, in Cuba, in Jamaica. They've been found in Florida. Some were recovered from the Atocha shipwreck. They have been uncovered in Jamestown, Virginia. They have been uncovered in the northeastern United States. And even as far north as Newfoundland. And the thinking is wherever Spanish ships and sailors visited, the Maravedis would have been carried with them. Now, that colonial connection in and of itself is interesting, but there are a couple other aspects about the Maravedis that I also find interesting. Their hammered, crude design is typical of many of the coins of that period, and studying Maravedis does require a bit of an analytical eye because of the inconsistencies that result from hammered coinage. These copper coins were definitely mass-produced, and quality control, as you can see, was not of the highest priority at the mints, and as a result, you have Maravedis that sometimes have taken on interesting shapes. And to my knowledge, there are no records of how many Maravedis were minted throughout the 1600s, but a lot of these coins, certainly hundreds of thousands of them, if not more, were minted to serve the purpose of small coinage and to raise funds for the Spanish treasury. The cost of collecting Maravedis is also a benefit to the collector because silver cobs, silver reals, from this period can be quite expensive. Well, a nice example of a 17th century Maravedi can be purchased for $25 or so. Now, if you do decide to purchase Maravedis, like this one, you'll find that they have dirt deposits on them, either from just sitting around for years or from being excavated, maybe. And that doesn't really affect their value. Unfortunately, you do see Maravedis for sale that have been cleaned, which, as is the case with most coins, is not advised. And I've also noticed that when you see Maravedis like this for sale, the dealers sometimes refer to them as pirate coins. Now, sure, there were pirates in the Caribbean and along the Atlantic coast when and where these coins circulated, and if they had Maravedis in their possession, they would have been used by pirates or any sailor when they went ashore. However, I don't think that pirate coin is a particularly sound description, because Maravedis were used by anyone in Spain or in the Spanish colonies who conducted small business transactions of any sort. And besides, I think any good pirate would have preferred a real or a gold escudo. But beyond that, coins do tell a story, and they contain ideas that are representative of the time and of the events in which they were produced. And Maravedis tell us a lot about a time when the Spanish Empire was arguably the richest and the most powerful nation in the world, yet was beset with financial problems. And we'll see how those events influenced the design of Maravedis a bit later as we examine some examples of these coins. Now, you can see this is a hammered cob, and just as a bit of an aside, the term cob is really an anglicized word. There are some theories as to how the term cob came into use to describe these types of hammered coins. Some folks limit the use of the term cob to describing gold or silvered or silver hammered coins or cut coins, but I don't follow that restriction. One theory about the word is that it comes from the old English word cob, because a cob is a small piece of something. So if you had a cob of coal, you would have a small piece of coal, and so forth. Another theory, and it's one that the British Museum seems to have adopted, is that the term comes from the Spanish word cobre, which is the Spanish word for copper. And another theory is that the term is derived from the Spanish phrase cabo de barra, which means end of the bar, and that sprung from the idea that these coins would have been made by forging a bar of gold or silver, in this case copper, cutting a piece of metal from the end of the bar, using dies to hammer the obverse and reverse design on that cut piece of metal, and then trimming the coin to the proper weight or within certain tolerances. And the clippings would then just be gathered and remelted into new bars and ultimately new coins. I read a comment by someone who does metalwork, and he proposed that cutting pieces of metal off the end of a bar and then stamping them is much easier said than done, and it really wouldn't be all that efficient of a way of mass producing coins. And his theory was that the Spanish and at other mints, they would melt metal, and the molten metal was poured into concave molds to create crude planchets, basically, that would then be hammered with dies and to me, that theory makes a bit more sense. But however the word cob was derived, the Spanish do not refer to these types of hammered coins as cobs. They refer to these crude hammered coins as macuquinas, M-A-C-U-Q-U-I-N-A-S, macuquinas. But whatever term you use, I think it's perfectly acceptable to refer to Maravedis as cobs. Most numismatists will know what you're referring to. But if you do see a listing for macuquinas, remember that they're referring to hammered cobs, coins like this. Okay, with that background covered, let's go ahead and take a look at the coins themselves. And we'll start with this one. So, as I said, this first coin is an 8 Maravedis. And on its this is the obverse, and on the obverse is a crown shield. You can see the crown up there and the shield. And within the shield is a castle, and that castle represents Castile, which was one of the Spanish kingdoms, and along with the kingdom of Leon, was the most powerful. And if you recall the story of Christopher Columbus asking Queen Isabella and King Ferdinand to finance his expedition to what would become the New World, he was really looking for an Atlantic passage to the Orient. Isabel and Ferdinand ruled Spain at that time, and they ruled from Castile and Leon. Those kingdoms are in the north central part of Spain and were the most powerful. Now, to the left of the shield, you might see or notice there's an M and a D, and that indicates that this coin was minted in Madrid. And to the right of the shield, you see, well, kind of the remnant of a Roman numeral. There's a V. What's left of the V? You can't quite see all of it because it was clipped. V. Then we have I, and I. There's a little bit of doubling there. And that's the Roman numeral 8. So we know this is an 8 Maravedis coin. Now, most of the legend, which would have appeared around the far edge of the coin, is obscured. But again, because of the crude way in which these coins were made. But we can make out here, DG, which stands for Dei Gratia, by God's grace, which referred to the divine rights of kings and queens. And on the reverse of the coin, I don't have my gloves on, but I don't think that will be an issue with this coin. Okay, on the reverse of the coin, we see another crown shield. And in this shield is a rampant lion, and that represents the kingdom of Leon. And to the right of the shield, we see a nice, fairly bold date. It's 1618, so we know that's when this coin was minted. And to the left of the shield, on most Maravedis, on the reverse, you'll see another one of the mint marks. But on coins minted in Madrid during the early 1600s, you sometimes see this clover design, and that indicates Madrid. And again, the legend is completely obscured because the coin was clipped and heavily circulated. But we can make out the very last part of E and X. And so that would be from Rex, which is a Latin term for king. And the king of Spain at this time was King Philip III, who reigned from 1598 to 1621. And that is a time when Spain's New World colonies were expanding greatly and producing enormous amounts of gold and silver and other treasures that were being shipped back to Spain in the great treasure fleets that you may have heard of. Treasures would be collected from New Spain, which is comprised of current-day Mexico and Central America, and from Tierra Firma, which is modern-day South America. Treasures also came from the Orient and were moved across land, across Mexico, to the Spanish port of Veracruz. And the two fleets, the New Spain fleet and the Tierra Firma fleet, would sail to Havana and would sail from Havana once a year to Spain and would hopefully make the journey back to Spain in about a month. And when they left Havana, the treasure fleets were protected by Spanish warships. There could be as many as 50 ships in a fleet. And while they were concerned about being attacked by pirates or privateers with a letter of marque or ships from hostile nations, they were most concerned about hurricanes. And King Philip ruled Spain in the early 1600s, and at that time, a large amount of gold and silver was coming into Spain, but the gold and silver was rather quickly spent on maintaining and expanding the colonies in the New World and building and maintaining a large army and navy to protect its interests in Europe and in the New World, and just as much, if not more so, to finance the wars that Spain was involved in against armies in the Netherlands and Germany and Italy and off and on with France and with England. There were also domestic conflicts in what is now Portugal, but in the 1600s that was part of Spain. So troops were placed throughout Spain as well, and kingdoms like Catalonia that were seeking more autonomy from Castile and Leon. So, all right, what does this gold and silver from the New World really have to do with these common copper coins? And there absolutely is a connection, because in the 1600s, domestic inflation was a big issue in Spain and in her colonies. And the Spanish crown knew it had to take steps to try and curb inflation by adjusting the money supply. But that had its problems too, because Philip III and his son, Philip IV, who became king in 1621, knew that the Spanish real had to maintain its value internationally. Its value was metallic, and it was directly based on the weight and purity of its silver content. Charlie mentioned this in his earlier stream, the real, hands down, was the most widely used silver coin in Europe for international trade. They were even used by Spain's arch rivals, the English and the Dutch. And the Spanish real was absolutely preferred to other nations' silver coins by the spice and silk and porcelain traders in the Orient. And in the 1600s, Spanish mints produced so much more silver coinage than England and France and the Dutch combined. So maintaining the metallic integrity of the real was critical to the Spanish economy. However, Philip IV, or more so his economic advisors, decided that the value of coins like this, the Maravedi, should and could be changed because it was a common copper coin that had a value based on seigniorage and could more easily be adjusted by royal decree. So in other words, the Maravedi's value was not based on a purely metallic value like the silver real or the gold escudo. And as a result, the value of the Maravedi, which again was widely used in modern commerce in Spain and in her colonies, would decrease and increase during the 1600s on the whim of the king and his advisors. So you look at this coin that was minted in 1618. This coin and others like it were worth 8 Maravedis, and that was the face value that appeared in the coin. But in 1628, 10 years after this coin was minted, the Dutch, under their Dutch West India Company fleet, managed to capture the entire Spanish treasure fleet and its riches in a battle called the Bay, in the Battle of Matanzas. It was off the coast of Havana. So even though in that year there was a lack of gold and silver flowing into Spain, inflation was still a huge issue and was plaguing the economy. So King Philip IV issued a decree that the mints would stop producing Maravedis, so he's trying to adjust the money supply, and that all coins like this, all Maravedis, in circulation would be worth half their face value. Okay, so why would he do that? Well, again, presumably the idea was that devaluing the copper Maravedis would result in decreasing the domestic money supply, and they could accomplish that without impacting the value of the real. So classic economic theory is that you can decrease inflation by reducing the money supply. So if the Maravedis in 1628, coins like this, if they were reduced in value, then people had less buying power, which the idea is, would ultimately result in lower prices and stave off inflation. Now, whether that was a good idea or not, the decree was put in place, and understandably, the devaluation caused a lot of confusion in Spain and in her colonies, for the lower classes in particular, because if you were a member of the lower classes, you probably only rarely saw a silver real. And now, what little money you had, what little copper money you had, was reduced by half. Now, that policy remained in place, and about 10 years later, in 1641, Philip IV decided to rescind that earlier devaluation, and he resumed the original face value of the Maravedis. And presumably that decision was made because inflation was a bit less of an issue and he wanted to increase the domestic money supply or bring it back to where it originally was without having to mint new coinage. Now in 1641, the problem was that the people still believed that these old 8 Maravedis they were only worth 4 Maravedis, because that was the king's decree. So they were reluctant to all of a sudden accept it again at 8 Maravedis. So you can imagine if you were, say, a sailor or a baker or a tavern owner, and you were told that the 8 Maravedis coin that you have, that the king ordered to be devalued to 4 Maravedis, was now worth 8 Maravedis, you'd probably be pretty confused too. So, to address this return to its original 8 Maravedis face value, the king also issued a decree that the old original copper Maravedis, coins like this, would be returned to the old mints and restamped to reaffirm their original value. So people would see a new royal stamp on these older coins that affirmed that these were worth 8 Maravedis again. And these coins would also be restamped with what was then the current date. By the way, the term that is used to describe a coin that is counter-stamped, so its original design is a counter-stamp on it, it, for Spanish coins anyway, is called Resello. So if you see a Maravedis and in its catalog listing it's described as Resello, then the coin has been counter-stamped in some way. And that change in value and restamping, I think, adds an interesting layer of history to these coins. And that's what you're going to see in the second coin. That's an example of a Resello. So in this coin, on the obverse, we again see the shield and a bit of the crown and the castle of Castile. And to the right, we can make out the last two digits of the Roman numeral 8. So it'd be VIII. And to the left of the shield would have been the mint mark, but we can't make that out. And we see the first counter stamp. So we see VIII. So we have 8, and that reaffirms its value of 8 Maravedis. And we know this coin was counter-stamped at the Madrid Mint because MD appears under this counter-stamp. And if we look at the reverse, and this is the reverse, and we see the crowned shield of Leon, we see the rampant lion, and we see here T, and we can make out a little bit of O, which tells us that this coin was originally minted at the Toledo Mint. And to the right of the shield, the original date would have been stamped, but it's pretty much obscured. But I don't know if you can see it, but I think I can make out a 2 and a 1. All right, right there, there's a little bit of a curve, and that's 2, and I think that's the bottom of 1. But that's just a guess on my part. But if that is correct, then this coin would have been minted at the Toledo Mint in 1621. And here we can see the coin was clearly counter-stamped in 1641. And there's a royal crown to indicate that it was done by royal decree. So that is a Resello. Oh, and by the way, okay, so moving along, here's another Maravedis, another 8 Maravedis. And again, we can see how crudely, you know, this part here and, you know, these edges aren't from circulation. It's just the way they were made. And on this Maravedis, we see, again, the shield and the symbol of Castile. And to the right, we can make out a Roman numeral 1. In fact, I think I can make out another bit there. So there would have been VIII. We certainly can't, or at least I can't, make out the mint mark on the left side of the shield. But we do see the VIII counter stamp. And it's difficult to see what the counter stamp is, but I see something here that has a little bit of a curve to it. At least that's what my eye sees. If it's a C, that would mean this was minted in at the Sequenza Mint. If it's a G, it would have been restamped at the Sequenza Mint or if it's a G, it would have been stamped at the Granada Mint. But that's just conjecture. Oh, and we see we see U.S. of Philippus, the Latin version of Philip. And on the reverse, we see a very clear original minting date. We see 1619. And can't make out the mint mark. But we also see the date of the revaluation, 1641. All right. Now, if this set of devaluations and revaluations seems confusing, it only gets worse. Because in the next decade, for whatever reason, and it may be best to let the historians and economists decide, King Philip IV issued a decree that the following year, in 1642, just 1 year after this resumed valuation, that these coins would again be devalued. But they were not restamped as such, but the values decreased and remained in place until 1651. Now, in that year, the values once again returned to their original face value. So you can just imagine how confusing this all would have been to citizens of Spain and in the colonies. So an 8 Maravedis coin like this, okay, originally minted in 1619 as an 8 Maravedis coin, its value decreased to 4 Maravedis in 1628. It was revalued and possibly counterstamped to its original value of 8 Maravedis in 1641, as this one would have been. In 1642, this same coin was again devalued by half and remained devalued until 1651. Then, in 1651, the crown decided, let's return these coins to their original value. And again, they were counterstamped to affirm the original face value. Are you following that? And if so, you're doing really well. But the thing to keep in mind is that during the 1600s, the value of Maravedis fluctuated depending on what the royal court thought was the best economic policy at the time. Now, we can see with this coin, that is an 8 Maravedis. And I have no doubt that it had an odd shape to begin with, but after being counterstamped twice and circulating heavily, it has a very smashed appearance. And on the obverse, you can just make out the bottom of the castle of Castile. So there's the bottom of the shield. That's sort of the base of the castle. Now, the original value to the right of the shield is completely obliterated, either from a weak initial strike or for circulation wear or just from being counterstamped. However, you can see, I think, let me do it like that. You can barely make out a V and then the I, and I. So this would have been an 8 Maravedis. We also know this was an 8 Maravedis because of its weight. And we can't make out the mint mark, which would have been there. But we can make out two countermark dates. We see here a 6 and a 4 and a 1. So that was the original countermark of 1641 when it was reaffirmed as an 8 Maravedis coin. And then if we flip it around, we see two digits. We see the last two digits of 1652. Now, notice the 5, it kind of looks like a 9, but that's how the 5s were written back then. The lower curve that would appear here that we're used to was more of a downward slash, so that's 52. So in 1652, this coin went back to one of the old mints and was counterstamped, and they counterstamped it with kind of a fancy design. Now, on the reverse of that coin, on the reverse of that coin, we can make out a few details. We see the arms of the rampant lion for Leon. We see a little bit of the crown. We see the edge of the shield. We see VIII, so the Roman numerals. That was from the 1641 revaluation. And there is a symbol underneath. I can't make that out. But that would indicate the mint it was restamped at. Then we have a second counter stamp. And this is the style that was used in 1652 to differentiate it from the previous counter stamp, even though they were the same amount. And this has an Arabic numeral, 8. And it was done, again, with kind of an elaborate design. Now, if you think the counter stamping of Maravedis stopped at this point, you unfortunately would be mistaken, because within a year, the values of the Maravedis were again reduced, and remained at this reduced rate until 1658, when yet another royal decree was issued that a new coin design would be minted. And these coins were to have a monogram, Philippus, on the obverse, and the monogram Rex on the reverse of the coin. Now, for whatever reason, very few of those coins ended up being minted. However, the mints were allowed to take old counterstamp Maravedis, like this, which are already heavily counterstamped, and stamp them with the Philippus and Rex monograms. And as you can imagine, they didn't look particularly good. But here's an example of one. Let's see. Oh, Rivendell coins. I have a question. What if someone was living far away and then came in town with an 8 marked unknowingly? How would that work out? Dish out another coin or punish for faking? There were some people who were punished for counterfeiting the marks. But if somebody came into town with a coin that was restamped as an 8 Maravedis coin, and then the decree was issued that the coin was worth 4 Maravedis, I think that the merchant would simply tell the purchaser that the coin was worth half its value, and you could either take it or leave it at that point. Was that what you were referring to, Cajun? If somebody had, you know, they simply didn't know what the value of the coin was, and they presumed and were trying to pass it off as a higher value coin, when in fact its value was cut in half? But yeah, it must have been an absolutely confusing time, and as a result of all these devaluations, understandably so, confidence in the Maravedis was at an all-time low. Whenever folks could, they would prefer silver reals, because their value pretty much... It didn't maintain its value completely throughout the 1600s. There were some devaluations, but nowhere near as seemingly random as these devaluations were. All right, now, this is an example, and it's difficult to see. This is an example of an 8 Maravedis coin, heavily, heavily circulated, that has the Philippus counterstamp on it. And the way it worked is you can kind of make out a little bit of the letter P. It goes like that. There's a curvature for the top of the P. And connected, these letters were all pretty much interconnected. And there's the P would go down here, and there's the leg of the L. Here we have an I, you can see the S, you can see the V, which in Latin is U, and then remember there would have been a line here, right, a vertical line here for the P, and there's a vertical line there for the I, and there's a horizontal line, and that would represent the H. Okay, so here's how Philippus was written. It was written P, H, I, L, I, then we go back to P, U, and S. Very crudely made, but that stood for Philippus, Philip. And on the reverse of the coin, we see an X, and then we see the remnants of an E in which there is also an R. So we have R, which is intertwined with E, and then we have X. So Philippus on the other side, and on the reverse, we have Rex. And underneath Rex, you can make out, we have 1, 6, 5, 9. So this was counterstamped with a Philippus Rex monogram in 1659. And you can also see an Arabic 8 under here, and this is a remnant counter stamp from the previous 1652 valuation. Okay, so at this point we're at 1659, and in 1660 Spain finally decided to create a completely new series of coins made of billin, that copper silver alloy, very low percentage of silver, to replace the old copper maravedis such as this. Now, instead of being hammered, these coins were going to be milled, and for the most part they were, so the coins would produce a more unified design like the other coins of Europe in the 1660s. And the hope was that these coins with that slight silver value would establish or reestablish confidence in this common coinage. And it was evident that, I mean, old coins like this looked pretty shabby, so they were probably more than willing to get rid of them. Now, a few years later, it was decreed that these old hammered Maravedis coins could no longer be used as coinage, and the hope was that these old copper coins would make their way back to the old mints and would be melted and made into the new coinage. But there's evidence that these continued to circulate in Spain and in the colonies well into the 1660s. And I can see why these would have circulated in the Spanish colonies if it would have taken time for the new coinage and news of the new coinage to make it out there. Let's see, and I do apologize, I'm kind of ignoring the chat here. Hey, Jordan, how are you? Thanks for stopping by. And hi, Gabe, thanks for coming by. Inquisition. Okay. There were horror stories about innocent people back then for that reason. Oh, yes, absolutely. There are some horror stories about the assayers down in Potosí, the silver mine down in Bolivia, who were, well, the idea was they were cheating the Spanish crown. And they were executed once they were found guilty. They did not stand for that sort of thing. Okay, so getting back to 1660, the silver, copper silver alloy coinage, they were made, but by 1664, so these coins were supposedly no longer valid for transactions. They were to be replaced by the silver alloy coinage of 1660. I don't have an example of that here, but those coins that were minted in 1660, the new design, by 1664, the crown decided that those coins would be devalued by half. And overall, the minting of Maravedi stopped around that time in 1644. The minting of the smaller coins, the 2 and 4 Maravedis coins, would resume in Spain in the early 1700s, but Spain wouldn't produce another 8 Maravedis coin until the 1770s. And by then, the design was completely different from the 1600 design. All right, so that in a nutshell is the story of the copper Maravedis that were minted in Spain and circulated in Spain and in the Spanish colonies in the New World in the early to mid-1600s. If you have any questions, I'd be happy to discuss them. Otherwise, we can do our giveaway. How are we doing for time? 10:38, not bad. Not bad at all. All right. Oh, I don't think I see any questions there. So, how about a giveaway? How many people do we have in chat? You know, I just have OBS running. I don't have the browser running. Well, I do have the browser running, but it's browsing in the YouTube beta. So, if somebody in chat could tell me how many viewers we currently have. And we'll go with that. We'll just do pick a number. Okay, Michael saying 25, Lincoln saying 28, 26. Okay, well, let's 26. Okay, well, let's do this. How about if you pick a number between 1 and 30. And when I type go, start guessing, and you can guess as many times as you like. Okay, so on your mark. So between 1 and 30, go. And here are the, those are the coins for the giveaway. Focus that. Okay, let me keep an eye on here. I do not see the number yet. Keep guessing. And yes, guess as many times as you want. Oh, you may stop. You may stop. Just double check. I definitely saw it, but the chat was going a little fast. I know I saw it. Yep, there it is. Okay, well, the number was 9, and if I am seeing this correctly, it looks like Miss Amy Yupa Girl was the first to choose that number. Or if Adriana's here, the letter 9. Yep. Well, that's what I see. Can somebody just go back and confirm? I mean, I saw 9 appear a few times, but on my chat... Yeah, my chat, it's clearly Amy. Congratulations, Amy. You got it. And let's see, Amy, I think I have you. I'm certain I have your email address. I have your email address. I'm certain I have your mailing address, so I can get those out to you. Unless your mailing address has changed, are you still where you were before? Well, I'll tell you what, Amy. You can. How about this? You can send me. Well, you know, it's funny. I didn't, when there was talk about the emails, I didn't get your email, Amy. And, Ken, if you're still here, I didn't get your email, but I closed the email client because I didn't want to have too many things running. But yes, if you want to either try emailing me or if you want to put something in YouTube Messenger, YouTube chat, that's fine too. But, and that's only if your address has changed. I know I have the address that was from the Valentine's Day coin swap. All right. Well, everybody, thank you so much. I hope you weren't you weren't bored too much. And there you have it. That is the numismatic and economic story of copper maravedis, makukinas, from the 1600s. And why they are designed the way they are. In fact, this one, Amy, this one's that happens to be a 4 maravedis, and it was revalued as 4 in 1636. And in this one, you can see a bit of the date. That's the Rex, the remnants of the Rex, R-E-U-X. And this one, well, we see 1654. That's the top of, yeah, that has to be the top of the castles, the turrets of the Castle of Castile. And anyway, you can have fun looking at those and trying to determine what it is. Okay, well, thanks again, everybody. I appreciate your spending the time here, and I hope you learned something, and I hope you enjoyed the presentation. And remember, if you have questions, obviously you can rewatch the video, but I should have on the video description a link to, it's a link to a page on the Rivendell coin site, but from there you can go directly to the files that I have. And one of those files is the show notes, the lecture notes for for this talk, and it has a timeline of all the events that I discussed, and it has a glossary of the terms, and has some other stuff, has a list of references if you're interested in learning more about Maravedis and Spanish coinage of the 1600s. Okay, everyone, well, this is the last Coin Week seminar class, to my knowledge, tonight, but be sure to tune in tomorrow and visit the Coin Seminar Weekend blog. I don't have the address for it, unfortunately, but be sure to do that. And in fact, if memory serves me, Shay, Manta Coins, is doing a class about OBS, and I'll certainly do that because... Actually, are you on here? I don't know if you're still here, Shay, but when I... When I first started this, there was a little bit of a panic because OBS told me that the screen resolution was set too low, and that wasn't ideal, but I hope the resolution worked and all that. Okay, everybody, I will sign out now. Thanks for watching. Have a great night. Be well, and I hope to see you soon.